When running a physical pen test, what is the best route to breach the building and achieve your objective?
Come out to the coast, we'll get together, have a few laughs.
In this video, we're going to talk about route selection. But first, what is a route and why do you need more than one? A route is any series of vulnerabilities that will take you from where you want to go to where you want to get to, ideally with the least amount of risk or effort on your part.
Technology gets better every day, that's fine. Most of the time, all you need is a stick of gum, pocket knife, and a smile.
That's disappointing.
All right, first things first, the information in this video is to be used for authorized penetration tests only.
See that apartment building?
Yeah.
Know anyone who lives there?
No.
Within 5 minutes, I want to see you standing in one of those balconies. Come on.
Getting paid to break into a building or physical pen testing is all about trying to locate as many vulnerabilities and routes as possible inside, then testing them to see if they're actually viable. When it comes to what is the actual best route, well, that's going to depend on things like what's in scope, the client's needs and motivations, your skill set, your equipment that you've got on hand that actually works, the time frame of the engagement, and the actual team size. Scoping is easy. If it's not in scope, then sadly, it's simply not allowed. This is true for a lot of things, like building scaling, downgrading security, or destructive entry. Sometimes the client will say, hey, look, we don't want you to break doors and windows. Fine, that's understandable. We don't want you to turn off our security in some way or downgrade it by, you know, overriding a security camera or downgrading a mag lock or anything along those lines. And your own company may say, hey, look, you know, we don't want to risk you falling off the side of the building in the middle of the night, so building scaling is off the table. Now, in some instances, this makes sense, but in sometimes this can be super frustrating. If you see an easy win, so, you know, say the CEO's office happens to be accessible through a fire escape, and you see that his door's cracked open in the middle of the night, that, you know, somebody just left that open that way, okay, that's an easy win, but if the client or your company says you can't scale the building, then, you know, write it down in the report, let the client know, and move on. Clients' needs are a bit trickier considering that you have to understand their motivation of why they hired you, but also it's very common for clients to not know what it is that they need. And this will, what they need and what their motivation is, will completely dictate what routes you choose. My advice is to always perform whatever the client wants, use your best judgment to go after what you think is important, and understand their motivation. When it comes to motivation for the client, if they're trying to scare the board into a larger security budget, then only use your very best route. Only use the one that's most likely to succeed without getting you caught. If their motivation is to just assess their security, then test every route, even if it's going to get you caught. Your skills and equipment obviously play a major role in deciding what the best route is going to be. For your skills, it's obviously going to come down to what are you good at and what are you even capable of doing. If you're a master lock picker, there's not a lock that you can't get through. But you can't talk to human beings to save your life without making everybody super awkward and uncomfortable. So all social engineering is off the table for you, right off the bat, right? And if you're a team lead and you've got somebody on your team who's super socially awkward, but they're like, no, I want to go inside, I want to be the social engineer, that's up to you to say no. But vice versa, suppose that you see that there's a rear door that goes directly to the server room that you have access to, but it requires you to pick a lock. And if you can't pick a lock to save your life, and there's no other way to bypass that door, then hey, even though that's a pretty tantalizing option, if you can't pick a lock, then you can't pick a lock. So you obviously want to assess which route is best for you based on what you are actually capable of doing. So after you've done all your recon and you've found your 5 or 10 methods of possible entry into the building and getting to wherever it is that you want to go, now you have to assess them based on which ones are most likely to get you caught and which ones can you actually do. So that's how you're going to make a major decision on what is and isn't the best route. One really common route for infiltration will be cloning an employee badge to impersonate someone. In order for this route to actually work, several things likely have to be true. One, the badge itself that the employees are wearing have to be clonable. Two, the employee has to wear the badge outside of the office. Three, the badge has to be in a badge holder that I can actually purchase or copy. And four, there's probably no secondary checking, no PIN codes, no anything else that would actually stymie me getting inside if I clone the badge. Now, in order to accomplish this fairly easily, I'm going to tell you a technique that I lovingly refer to as the walking RFID. Now, generally speaking, this works best in something like a shared office space, but it doesn't have to. Shared office spaces are often kind of easy wins because this means that anybody can enter into the target building. Usually there's a canteen or a cafeteria or something else on the ground floor, but at a bare minimum, this is an office where you have many, many different companies all in the same space, so nobody knows everybody. It makes an easy way to blend in. So let's suppose, for the sake of argument, that we've got a cafe inside the ground floor of a shared office space. Now, one of the easiest things to do with the walking RFID technique is you're going to have a long-range card reader in your backpack, you're going to have a second long-range card reader in a briefcase, and you're going to have something like a flipper with an extender running up to your sleeve or your palm of your hand. Now, all of these things are going to be important. The idea here is simple. You sit at the cafe near the barista, looking at the door. When the target walks into the cafe, you take a quick glance at what they're wearing, make sure it's the right employee, and where they're wearing their badge. If their badge is around the neck, you're going to grab your backpack. And as soon as they walk into the door, you're going to grab your backpack with the card reader facing behind you and get in front of them. Now, this is fairly easy, right? Now we're standing, in line together, and because they're behind me and I've got a long-range card reader pointing in that direction, as long as I take my time and adjust, figuring out what kind of coffee and scones and other things that I want, there's a very good chance I'll get that badge. If, by contrast, the employee happens to be wearing something on their belt, then I grab my briefcase, again with a card reader inside, I let them go in front of me, I grab a cup or something that I've been using, and I walk up behind them, and I lean across to hand the barista my empty cup or something, or I ask them, oh hey, I'm sorry, where do I put this? All the while putting my briefcase close enough to get that badge read. In another event of if they put their ID badge on a table, you can put your bag on top of the badge because there's a long-range reader in both your backpack and your briefcase. You can just put your briefcase on top. But I like to bring a flipper with a extender running up to my palm because sometimes that looks a little awkward. So sometimes if you drop something or if you whatever, and you just lean down, so you've got the RFID reader running up to your palm, you put your hand right on the card, you lean down to grab something for a few seconds. That sometimes looks a little better than putting something heavy and bulky like a backpack or a briefcase right on top of their card. But it's up to you how you play it. I just like to cover my bases. Now, all of that said, this is a very easy and very common strategy for stealing badges, stealing credentials. But all of this is predicated on the idea that you have all of this equipment. So what happens if you know how to do this? You know how to set this up. You've recognized the vulnerabilities. You've assessed that this will work, but you don't have a long-range card reader. The only thing you have at your disposal is a flipper, okay? So you've got a $100 flipper with you, and that's the only thing you have. So suddenly, even though this is a very viable route on your hypothetical engagement, you don't have any of the devices necessary to actually do it. And then, of course, there's the other aspect of it. What if you have the equipment, but then come the day of the engagement, your equipment breaks?
But be careful. The cap slips off for, no reason.
So when you're trying to decide what is the best route, say you've done all your reconnaissance, say you've found 20 or 30 vulnerabilities, and you've pieced together 5 or even 10 routes into the building that you think are likely, and the top choice for you isn't an option because it's not in scope. Maybe you can't scale the building, maybe you can't downgrade security, etc. Or maybe it's because it's beyond your skill set. Maybe there's a rear access door that goes directly into the server room, but you can't pick a lock to save your life, so it's not an option for you. Or lastly, what happens if you want to do, say, the walking RFID thing, but you don't have any long-range card readers? That's an easy win, but you don't have the equipment to actually pull it off, and therefore, it's not a viable route for you. So when you're doing route assessment, realize that a lot of this is going to come down to what is in scope, what are you good at, what equipment do you have at your disposal, and lastly, what is your team size and your time frame? Your team size is going to dictate how bold you can be and how fast certain tasks like reconnaissance are able to be accomplished. If you have, say, 5 to 10 people on your team, that's a good-sized team. You will be able to run through recon very quickly, and you'll be able to try more tricky or out-of-the-box thinking because you can afford to have things like burner teammates, people who you purposefully throw under the bus so that other teammates can privilege escalate. You can run social engineering things that require 2, 3, 4, 5 people at a time in order to pull off. There's a lot more viable methods or available methods to you the bigger your team size is. But by contrast, if your team size is 1, it's literally just you, you are a lone engagement, then recon is going to take a really long time. And you have to be much more careful because you have no one to back you up. You have no room for error. If you personally get burned or caught, the game is over. The jig is up.
Okay, what did you tell her? 1, you're straight. 2, you're engaged. 3, tomorrow's your girl's birthday. And 4, you have no taste in women's fashion. What if she were an asset? You told her 4 lies that now have to be true.
So it really depends on what you have. So again, you may find a great route, but if it requires 2 or 3 people to pull off, well, then it's not viable to you. When it comes to the time frame, obviously, however long you're given to do this engagement is going to play a major role in which route is best for you. If you discover through elicitation or recon that every Friday or every other Friday, your client has janitorial staff who show up after hours, they unlock all the doors, they turn off all the alarms, breaking in at that time and impersonating an employee, it's an easy win. It works very often. But if the engagement window doesn't cover that day, well, then it's not even an option for you. So you don't even need to consider or worry about it. By contrast, however, if you've got a month or two to play out your engagement, then not only can you do that kind of thing, but you can do it over and over again. You can develop assets, which is effectively turning employees and internal people like janitors or cooks or cleaners into people on your team without them knowing it, right? By building rapport and social engineering them. So which types of routes you pick can completely dictate based on how long you're given by the client to actually pull this off. So to return to the original question of this video, what is the best route into the building? Well, the best route into the building is not necessarily the easiest route. It's not necessarily the most likely to succeed route. It's the route that's most likely to succeed based on these premises. What's in scope? What are the client's needs and motivations? Your skills and equipment, the team size and the time frame. Because the easiest route into the building may be the hardest route or impossible if it's outside of your scope, outside of your skill set, or outside of your equipment availability. So assess what is possible. Identify all the vulnerabilities. Put together as many routes as you can. And then, based on your skills and these parameters, figure out what's most likely to succeed for you and your team. And that is going to be the best route into the building.